Bologna is known for a great many things, but I think above all, the top two things it's known for are, one, its university. It's got the oldest university in the world, established in 1088. This is basically the birthplace of third level education. The other thing it's well known for is, of course, its meat sauce. Have you ever had spaghetti al bolognese? It's actually bolognese, that's how you say it, spaghetti al bolognese. In fact, more often here they have fettuccine al bolognese. That's more traditional here. And that's where it comes from, right here in Bologna. They're also very well known for their tortellini, usually served in brodo, in broth, a hot broth. Great dish during the winter months. Their tortelloni, which are the big tortellini, the big fat ones, usually with ricotta cheese inside and served with meat sauce on top, the ragu as they call it here. Bologna comes from here, from Bologna. That's where bologna comes from. Actually, locally here they call it mortadella, and it comes in various different types. But for the Italians, they think of Bologna as something else. Bologna is kind of like a hub. It's a bit like a Dallas or a Newark or something like that. A lot of big industry lands in Bologna and then goes out from there. You'll notice it even with the train station here. Normally train stations in Italy are above ground, they're quite quaint and so on. The train station here is scary as hell. It goes down several levels underground. It's like a massive airport because it's kind of a center hub for the entire big network of trains going through Italy. In fact, most major train lines make a stop through Bologna on their way to the north or the south or vice versa. You also notice it with big musical acts, you know, British and American rock bands and stuff. On their way through Europe on tour, there's usually three places they'll play here in Italy. Rome, of course, the capital, Milan, and Bologna. Another thing Bologna is known for is its portici, the porticos or arcades. It's basically when the second floor of the buildings juts out over the sidewalk and they build an arch to support it. That way you're kind of covered as you walk down the street. So if it's raining out and so on, it won't really make any difference. If you remember the episode I did in Padova, there was a lot of portici there too, but they were quite small and snug and cozy. The portici here in Bologna are quite big and majestic. In fact, Bologna has more portici than any other Italian city, stretching for about 30 miles, going all the way up to a sanctuary at the top of a hill called San Luca, which overlooks the city. Italians don't get enough credit for their beers. They make amazing beers, I think, and they're not known for beer making at all. You know, it's all about Belgian beers, German beers, American beers. I think Italians make fantastic beers. This is a local artisan style red beer. It's almost like a stout. It's really beautiful. Love it. Behind me here is the Casa Isolani, the famous location of the Tre Frecce, the three arrows. The legend goes that there were three assassins hired to take out a guy who lived in this building. Every morning he would come to the window and open up to let the air in. Well, they were ready, poised with their arrows, to take him out. But before they got to do that, at one of the adjacent windows, a beautiful woman arrived and opened up, and she was topless. They got so distracted at this amazing vision, they let go of their arrows by accident, and they all flew in random directions and hit the underside of the wood up here. So people come from all over the world now to take photos of the Tre Frecce, the three arrows of Casa Isolani. I've seen a lot of these kind of pop-up cheap clothing markets in
various towns in Italy, they're usually full of, you know, elderly ladies, senior citizens looking for warm clothing and deals and all of that, you know. You can never get between a 70-year-old woman and a bargain, you know, especially with the Italians. But this one's got an extra edge, I think. This one clearly is facilitating also the large student contingent. After all, students are usually living hand to mouth, right? You can see a fair amount of young people looking for some warm clothes for the winter approaching.
I was surprised to discover that there is a park here called the September 11th Park, dedicated to the loss of those people in New York back in 2001. I wondered why they have something like that here in Bologna. It's not exactly their tragedy. But then it occurred to me that this is a town of towers. There's about 100 towers peeking up into the skyline above this town, including their own twin towers, which are the Asinelli Towers right in the center. One of them is particularly high and a lot of people go up there to check out the panorama of the city. So perhaps that's why they felt a certain kinship. Of course, their towers are a lot older, but maybe they feel a certain kinship with New York.
This is Bologna's main square, the Piazza Maggiore. And just like any square, it's where everybody comes to meet up and hang out. Lots of families sitting around, little cafes, bars, etc. But there is one thing you won't see in the piazza, and that is a student. The university here is so old that it carries with it a lot of superstition. Typical stuff. And one of the superstitions is that if a student is to cross the piazza, even just to get from one side to the other, that they will not graduate. It'll jinx them and they won't be able to graduate. So even if a student is in that building there and they need to get to that building there, they'll take the long way around. They'll leave the piazza and go out onto the Strada Maggiore and come back around, because they're terrified it'll jinx them. The same goes for the Asinelli Tower, that big tall tower. Everybody goes up there to check out the panorama. It's an amazing view up there. But students won't, because the same superstition is attached to it, that they won't graduate if they see the view from the top of that tower. They will not graduate at university. So rather than tempt fate, they just avoid it completely. Now, I have my own little theory about this, to be honest with you. I think it's just so many students in the town that they made up these superstitions just to keep them from clogging up these beautiful spots. Because if it were students in this piazza here, you wouldn't be able to swing a cat. It'd be just packed constantly. And of course, the same goes for the Asinelli Tower. They'd probably be up there all the time too. So in order to keep these beautiful prime locations here in Bologna a little clear of all the students, they came up with these superstitions. It's a brilliant way to make people avoid a particular place. At least that's my theory. Remember Hunt for Red October? He's like, how are they going to get people to get off the submarine? They're going to have to want to get off.
How do you get a crew to want to get off a submarine? How do you get a crew to want to get off a nuclear sub?
Tell them a terrible tale and then watch everything else fall into place. It's a great idea, really. Other cities should use this. Brilliant. This is the Fountain of Neptune, and there is the god of water right there himself, looking very regal and very cool, I must say. It's kind of a centerpiece here. And it's said that if you go to a certain stone here on the ground and look at the statue from a certain angle, his hand looks like something else. Let's check it out. There's some stone over here. Let me see if I can find it. It's darker. There it is there. This one. And if you look at him from here, his hand, yeah, looks like an effing big boner. Hilarious. Nice one. Unfortunately, he isn't actually as well endowed as it would appear from this angle at all. Too bad. Even that pigeon's impressed. One thing Bologna does not have is silence. This is a loud, noisy town. There's traffic passing right through the historic center here. There's motorcycles and scooters all around the place. Guys on push bikes delivering food. Buskers, the cacophony of various bars, the radio blasting and so on. It's a loud and bustling city. At the same time, it's so ancient and historic and beautiful. It's like a mix between New York and Florence. If New York and Florence had a baby, it would be Bologna. Inside here is the anatomical theater. Its rooms contain the first written accounts of the studies of chemistry, biology, and the human body. In order to understand how something works, it makes sense, of course, to open it. And this is the first place they ever did that. The autopsy table is quite chilling to stand next to and to imagine all these students from over the centuries gathering in that room as they watched human bodies being dismantled. These are the first accounts of man beginning to understand how the human body worked. Its books document all their findings from over the centuries. The library itself is not accessible to tourists, but if you are a student of the University of Bologna, you have free access anytime you like. This video is sponsored by Carl Fred Rieck. I've been using their products now for a couple of years and I absolutely love them. They're just super high class, super minimalist. I must have 10 or 12 wallets and this is my favorite one, the Swampfield from them. I've been using it ever since they gave it to me. On this trip, I brought their newly designed suitcase, the Carry On Pro. It's just amazing. I love the silence of the wheels, the ease of use of the whole thing. It's just perfectly sized and perfectly designed, like all the other Carl Fredrik stuff. This new one has a front pocket you can put your
laptop into your passport and keys and things like that, so you don't have to go popping open the whole case to get at those things. And as always, I love that feature with the USB charger. It's just great if you can't see any outlets around you. You always have that extra power for your phone. That is an optional extra, but I definitely think it's worth it. It's an interesting story about this watch, actually. I was wanting a Datejust for quite some time. Something from the side of the catalogue that's very kind of sparkly and high society. If you imagine Rolex being divided into two, on one side you have the Sub, the Sea Dweller, the Explorer 2, those kind of strong, aggressive, sporty looking watches. And then on the other side you have the Datejust, the Day-Day, maybe the Daytona's in there too. Very kind of sparkly, blingy, high society, dazzling looking watches, and very classic Rolex as well. Well, I finally found this one, exactly the config I wanted, on the Jubilee, blue dial, and of course, sparkly fluted white gold bezel. At the London Watch Show last year, September, and I picked it up and I was delighted. I figured I'm going to be wearing this watch every day now for quite some time. But weirdly, a few days later, I actually also picked up a rose gold Daytona on the Oyster Flex, also a stunning piece. So of course, which one got all the attention? The Daytona, naturally, because it's just such an icon. So in a way, this watch's moment in the limelight in my collection was short-lived, and it wound up kind of in the watch box for a while. Then later I moved up to AP and so on. So it kind of got brushed to one side, strangely enough. Finally, I'm really wearing the watch and getting it out there on the wrist. It feels like such a gentleman's watch. That's a great thing about the Day-Dates and Datejusts. They just have that gentlemanly classic Rolex look to them. Even people who don't know anything about watches, when they see something like this, they can probably guess it's a Rolex. It just has that look to it. I just love how elegant it is, how it wraps around the wrist beautifully. It's not top heavy. It's got a very luxurious kind of sexy contour to the case. And of course, with the white gold fluted and the Jubilee, it's just a light magnet. It's just a sparkle show. It's like a Christmas tree. It just lights up in any room. It just grabs all the light from around, like be a candlelight in a restaurant or ambient light. It just keeps sparkling and shining every time you move your wrist. For the longest time, the Datejust was somewhat ignored. Everybody wanted Subs and GMTs. It's still somewhat the case. Whereas the Datejust, in many cases, you could walk into a Rolex authorized dealer with no spend history at all and walk out with a Datejust. That's no longer the case, especially not with the blue dial or now the new mint green dial. They're very sought after pieces. They're weightless pieces, just like the Subs and GMTs and so on. I think that the Datejust really is the quintessential Rolex. It's just, it's got all of that look from it, from across the room. Even if you don't know anything about watches, I'm sure you could probably guess it's a Rolex. It just has that kind of high society, dazzling look from it. Not much of a little Venice. They don't have any water in the damn thing. Thank you. And there you have it, guys. I hope you enjoyed that. Bologna is pretty wild. I'm not sure I'd move here. I think I'm too attached to the serenity of Venice at this point. But it's nice knowing that the town is here if I need it. I'm sure the nightlife here is probably electric, considering the amount of students here and considering the size of the city. It's probably great to be young in this town. But for me, after 20 years in New York, I think I've had my days of doing that stuff, so I'm gonna just hang back in Venice for the moment. But I hope you enjoyed that, and thanks again for watching the channel. I will see you in the next one.